It's been 10 years since Julia Gillard took the top job, and Australia reacted to its first female leader.
I'm putting her in a chaff bag and hoisting her to the Tasman Sea.
Ditch the witch! Ditch the witch!
When you look back at the time and think back to those things, do you feel less angry or more angry?
Less, I suppose. Even when I was there, I didn't let too much of that hurt in. You know, I built a bit of a barrier between the real me inside and all of this going on around me. I really couldn't let it directly in, but it was frustrating. We called one of the chapters of the book She's a Bit of a Bitch because we actually looked at the research that shows that people do think women leaders can be unlikable. You know, I think women intuitively know this. They mightn't be across all the research, but their lived experience tells them that it's like this.
Well, Malcolm Turnbull recently said that what you endured, a lot of those things, was off the charts. Did he do enough during that time to speak up, if that's how he felt about your treatment?
I saw that Malcolm said that, and I'm glad he said it, because that's a contribution to this discussion we have to have, that someone, a man from the other side of politics, would, you know, reflect on the gendered treatment and look at it as its own thing that needs to be resolved.
But isn't it quite easy to reflect? It's different to speak up at the time. Do you feel like enough people spoke up at the time?
No, broadly, I don't. I mean, I think I didn't do enough at the time. So I regret that I didn't call it out earlier and start the conversations we need to have earlier.
Why do you think men, but also women, are scared, though, to speak up when they see it happening around them?
I think people worry about how it's going to backwash on them. Research shows that if you've got groups of five people who are talking about a problem, women will only get a fair share of the talking time if the group is four women and one man. Well, it's not that hard for all of us, is it, to sit in groups and say, oh, Carrie hasn't spoken yet, why don't we hear what Carrie's got to say, so that everybody gets a go and everybody gets to put an opinion. We can all do that.
I will not be lectured about sexism and misogyny by this man. I will not. And the government will not be lectured about sexism and misogyny by this man. Not now, not ever.
8 years on, the 2012 misogyny speech continues to cement its place in history, with the original upload now sitting at 3.4 million views. It's even been revealed the Obama White House would watch the speech when they were annoyed with Tony Abbott. Most recently, it's found a new audience on TikTok.
I will not be lectured about sexism and misogyny by this man.
It's continuously fascinating to me, and in some ways gratifying, that the misogyny speech continues to get so much attention and to live new lives, like on TikTok. I think it's that cool anger that propels the speech and has made it much remarked upon. I had no idea that it would be remarked upon beyond the evening news and the next day's newspapers. No sense whatsoever that it had reverberated beyond Parliament House in the way it clearly did when it was given and has done all of these years since.
Gladys Berejiklian was asked a couple of weeks ago about what she made of the speech, and she noted that she hadn't seen it. She'd only seen the commentary around it. Does that surprise you that she wouldn't have seen that speech?
Oh, not necessarily. I mean, I kind of know where she's coming from, in the sense that I can understand why a political leader, whether it's Gladys or anybody else, wouldn't necessarily want to be drawn on, you know, their musings about politics as a boys' club in a particular moment when she's probably out trying to talk about COVID-19 and keeping people safe.
Julia says she used to be an analytical feminist, but now says she's much more of a sensitive one.
Can you be a sensitive, emotional leader of a country? Is that the issue?
I think there's limits, you know. I'm really interested in Jacinda Ardern and her model of leadership. I think it's a model that, in a nation that's on its third female prime minister, perhaps there's a bit more space for it than when you were the first. And she does foreground kindness and empathy, and she seems to be able to do that without people coming back with a critique that she's not strong enough.
In her new book, her chapter titled Doing the Numbers highlights some depressing stats. In 92 years of Academy Awards, only a single woman has won the Oscar for Best Director. Of the 193 UN member nations, only 57 have had a female leader. And out of the Fortune 500 companies, the highest percentage of female CEOs at one time was just 6.6%.
You were attacked for how you retained power, yet other male leaders had done exactly the same thing, attained it in very similar fashion. Do you think women are held to a higher standard for how they play the game?
Politics is a competitive business and it's inherently a competition. I do think, and the book clearly shows through the psychological research, that people judge women in those competitive races more harshly than they judge men. And I think some of that played out in my treatment, absolutely.
Are you glad you're not having to lead the nation through what's happening at the moment?
Oh, look, you go into politics because you believe you can make a difference. You go for the good times and the bad times. I didn't particularly present to politics to run the nation during a pandemic. But if I was there now, I would absolutely accept the weight of the leadership that's needed.
So you think Scott Morrison's been doing a good job?
I think Scott's been doing a good job. I think everybody's taken their responsibility seriously and have put their collective shoulders to the wheel. And I think that that's been, you know, fantastic to see.
Do you think we'll see another female Prime Minister here in Australia?
Oh, look, I'm very optimistic about that. I frequently joked I'd like to live long enough to see so many that it all becomes, you know, when people are doing Trivial Pursuit style quizzes and people say, how many female prime ministers have we had? No one gets the answer right because it's so routine to have women in power that no one keeps the count anymore. I'd like to see that.
Well, there may not be the question in that situation. Mm. The speech of hers is most underrated is after she lost her job. And she gave that speech where she spoke about how sexism explains some things and not everything. It was a really powerful speech. We never talk about that one. I feel like that was the real moment where she began to open up about this. And I know in this book she talks about a lot of leaders around the world.
That's what's fascinating, Hillary Clinton, Theresa May, and the fact that it is a worldwide experience, that even though it's slightly different depending on what country you live in, the experience of getting to the top for women is very different to men.
Yeah. And that it's universal. That's the common thread.
That is universal. Yeah. Yeah. And Julia's book, Women and Leadership, Real Lives, Real Lessons, is available now wherever good books, ebooks, and audiobooks are sold.